So our next speaker is Francesca Lolicato. Francesca has been working in various aspects of oocyte biology over the years. She has also studied the involvement of autophagy in the degradation of paternal mitochondria in developing porcine embryos. And she is presently working as a postdoctoral fellow in the ovarian follicle biology unit at the Free University of Brussels in Belgium, under the mentorship of Professor Johan Smits. So Francesca, please.
Thanks. So first of all, I would like to thank all the organizers and also Professor Johan Smits, who gave me this opportunity. So as you can see from the title of my talk, I'm going to talk about the role of cumulus cells in the acquisition of oocyte competence, but from a specific point of view, that is with a specific focus on human IVM, which is actually the main core of my project since 1 year and a half in Brussels. So I will start from the basic assumption that competent oocytes result from an active dialogue with the cumulus cells. Indeed, we know that the follicular environment is determining the competence of the oocyte. However, while the bulk growth of the oocyte is happening during the preantral phase, it is in the antral phase that instead the oocyte is acquiring the developmental competence and all the molecular and cytoplasmatic mechanism that will support later on then the fertilization. IVM. Since IVM was described the first time in the 30s, it was immediately visible that it could be an important model for studying the latest phases of oogenesis. In several animal models in which it was applied, it was a good platform for also the producing a lot of breeding species for valuable agriculturally. But specifically, when we talk about human IVM, which was instead firstly introduced in 1994, especially for PCOS as alternative therapy treatment for PCOS patients, immediately it became visible that the main outcome was not so good, not so comparable with the IVF. The main reason for this is that when we are talking about IVM, we are targeting these sides of follicle in between mostly 6 and 10 millimeter. And the impaired results that were obtained were then coming, first of all, from the fact that we know that in this antral follicle, in this small size antral follicle, the oocytes are lower competent. And also because of our limited knowledge, understanding about actually how to mature in vitro this kind of oocytes in order to get competent oocytes. This morning, we just have a very interesting debate about indeed natural versus stimulated cycles IVF, and we have indeed got even more clear which is the how complicated it can be to get a sufficient amount of oocytes to fertilize. So in some way, my main point, the point I want to make here is then what if we, by manipulating or by modulating maturation system, we could target even smaller sites, antral follicle, oocytes coming, deriving from smaller sites, antral follicle, which, as you can see also from this picture, actually are the follicles that are always present in the ovary. So I'm going to try to share with you some results that we recently submitted about the development of this kind of system. In order to do this, I want to first refresh some of the main points of the related with the in the importance of the communication between cumulus cells and oocytes. We had already several lectures about this, so I am just going. I will just try to summarize the main aspects that may be also the special interest reference with the IVM. So we know that through all the folliculogenesis, one of the important aspects is really represented by the support of the somatic cells for the oocytes grow by transferring indeed ions, nucleotides, molecules, small molecules. Also, the the specific contact association with the cumulus cells have been demonstrated to be of special importance in the regulation of a special organization and function of the meiosis spindle, first of all of the GV localization and then of the meiosis spindle through a mechanism dependent, through acting dependent mechanism. Then another very important aspect that is also of special relevance for the IVM is really the coordination of nuclear and cytoplasmatic meiotic competence. Then the modulation of chromatin remodeling and transcriptional silencing. And it is more recent results from the last 2 years, also the contribution to the maternal reserves by actively transferring small mRNA and large molecules, also long non-coding RNA. Even if Professor Albertini also already talked about different ways through which this communication is exerted, I will focus here especially on the two main structures that are involved in this process and that are the, transzonal projections and the gap junctions. And I want to focus especially on these structures because we really believe that the maintenance of this contact and the integrity of these structures during IVM is of special importance in order to achieve competent oocytes. And the oocyte itself is not merely a container, so to say, of the cumulus cells' activity, but it's rather a bidirectional communication. And the oocyte itself, it is indeed also regulating several cumulus cells' functions that are listed here. Like proliferation, growth of the follicle, cumulus cells apoptosis, luteinization, metabolism, and mussification and expansion. And how the oocyte is doing this is mainly via oocyte secreted factors, and specifically I will refer to BMP15 and GDF9, which are indeed working via specific receptors on the cumulus cells via activating the SMAD cascades, the transducer cascade. And it has been shown already in several also animal models that oocyte secreted factors can be also added as supplements during IBM in order to improve indeed the later competence. And indeed it is, especially it is for last summer, the press release about also purified recombinant form, heterodimer form of the BMP15 and GDF9 and the use also in this during human IVM. So the point here is then how to, we can use this knowledge to improve the current IVM system in human. As I was saying, the IVM was introduced already in the animal model, and it was definitely more successful than in the human model. And the reason for this, indeed, is that even when the fully grown oocyte, the oocyte is completely grown, still it is kept under a meiotic arrest till the ovulation. So what became clear is that in the moment in which we retrieved the oocytes from the small follicles, smaller follicles than the ones targeted indeed from by the IVF, what is happening is, first of all, there is a spontaneous resumption of meiosis, which actually can impair the synchronism of the nuclear and cytoplasmatic maturation, and eventually also leading to a loss of this contact between the oocyte and the cumulus cells. Therefore, the first attempt for trying to overcome this, this problem was the introduction of a so-called prematuration phase, so-called because indeed was a culture that was preceding the maturation culture itself. Also called as capacitation of the oocyte. What is this about? So basically in the prematuration, during a prematuration phase, we aim to keep the GB oocyte under meiotic arrest for a certain amount of hours. And the important point is that this connection with the cumulus cells should be preserved. The fact to have a period of different hours, which may vary, also help us or allow us to play with different cumulus cells regulators or other nutrients, which may eventually come later during the development, and then helping in supporting then the oocyte competence. How was this attempt, this maintenance in the prematuration phase? As we know, the meiotic arrest in vivo condition is really based on the concentration of a cyclic MP within the oocyte. So the first approach was mostly either pharmacological. And so the maintenance into meiotic arrest was attempted either by using cyclic MP analogs or phosphodiesterase inhibitors. However, the main point was that not always was possible to maintain under meiotic arrest the oocytes a sufficient amount of hours for allowing a proper synchronization of nuclear and cytoplasmatic maturation, and most important, by making use of this pharmacological approach like inhibitors, phosphodiesterase inhibitors, mostly the transzonal projections were not preserved, and so the communication between cumulus cells and oocytes was not kept. It is more recent, there was in 2010 was firstly described then more physiological meiotic inhibitor, termed CMP, or natriuretic peptide type C. And this is actually what we were testing in our system. So what it is CNP? CNP is a peptide which is encoded by this gene, NPPC, so it's also known as NPPC. And it belongs to the family of natriuretic peptide together with the atrial and brain natriuretic peptide, which are involved in the body fluids homeostasis. However, this third type C peptide, despite it was isolated from the brain, was not showing a natriuretic activity. And another important information is that also this peptide is constituted is 126 amino acids, but only the C-terminal 22 last residues are representing are constituting the active and the mature peptide, and this is a region which is highly conserved between different species. So I'm going to describe a little bit more about the mechanism of this peptide and how is which is the role in the meiotic arrest maintenance. So we know indeed, as I was saying, that the meiotic arrest is maintained via keeping a high concentration of cyclic AMP within the oocyte. The oocyte itself, it is able indeed to produce cyclic AMP via an enzyme, the adenylate cyclase, which is under control of G proteins. And also there is a supply from the cumulus cells toward the oocyte. And cyclic AMP itself, then, it is activating a phosphorylase, which via different effectors is inhibiting the prematuration factor or maturation or meiotic factor. And then, therefore, maintaining the oocyte under meiotic arrest. How is then CNP playing a role in this process? So CNP, it is produced by mural granulosa cells. And it is binding receptors on cumulus cells, NPR2. Within the cumulus cells, it's then enhancing the production of cyclic GMP, which is then transferred through the gap junctions to the oocyte. And cyclic GMP is the natural inhibitor of the phosphodiesterase 3, which is the enzyme responsible of degradation of the cyclic CMP. Therefore, there is a positive feedback and concentration of cyclic MP is kept high within the oocyte. This, there is also a positive feedback and influence on this process exerted by estradiol and oocyte secreted factors. More recently, in 2012, Tsuji and others also show a possible involvement of CNP also in the meiotic resumption. And how this is happening, beside the known pathway, independent pathway of the closure of gap junctions, under LH surge and via amphiregulin signal, it is downregulating the expression of NPPC mRNA. Therefore, the source of CNP will be not available anymore, and there will be a drop in cyclic GMP, and therefore then a drop in cyclic MP and resumption of meiosis. I explain this because this further supports the need during an IVM system to have indeed present cumulus cells to make this physiological pathway possible. So CNP then, as I was saying, was already recognized as a physiological meiotic arrestor, inhibitor, and it was already used in different animal models. So you can see that there is a lot of variety from cat to bovine to mouse or porcine. And in all the cases, these works were showing that when it was possible, that CNP was allowing to maintain under meiotic arrest for a limited amount of hours, usually around 6 hours, the GB oocytes. And this pre-maturation capacitation phase was then correlating with an improved blastocyst yield. However, we first of all decide to test to evaluate the use of the CMP in a IVM system in a mouse model, which could be extremely stringent, just to try to get a more comparable system with the condition in which the oocytes are retrieved from a small antral follicle in human. Therefore, we decide, first of all, to use to collect COC that were, so to say, extremely immature from human ill 19 up to 21 days old mice, and absolutely with no priming. And then we establish a culture system in which the block, the meiotic arrest could be
Francesca,
kept.
You have 5 minutes.
Oh, okay, sorry. Could be kept up to 48 hours. So here I'm going to show them quickly the main results in terms of blastocyst yield, which was improved in comparison with IVM system from the same oocytes without pre-IVM, and the other control was the IA in vivo. And the blastocyst yield was indeed significantly improved by CMP medium supplemented together with FSH and GDF9. And when we look at the transzonal projections, also we could see that they were properly maintained and up to 1.85-fold higher. This quantification was done via fluorescent signal were compared with the same condition pre-IVM. But with a pharmacological inhibitor, with cilostamide. I will go a little bit, well, and since we know that this maintenance is also correlating with the nuclear chromatin configuration, we also analyzed this and we could see that CNP supplemented medium was promoting oocytes growth and inducing a shift in the chromatin configuration toward a condensed configuration, which is more compatible with competent oocytes. Then, I think I will need to just to skip a few slides. I will do a step back. Why are we so interested and we are still believing in IVM, even if the first results were not, let's say, so promising, or at least they were not. It was shown that was not so efficient as IVF. We believe that it is indeed easier for the patients, and it has a lot of positive aspects, which are less consultation, less monitoring, less injection, less cost, which could make this procedure actually extremely valuable not only for PCOS patients but also for so-called normal ovulatory women. Of course, there are still some negative aspects that need to be either improved or understand. And among them, I can just mention the learning curve in the OPU. The collection of the retrieval oocytes from smaller follicle is more complicated than from larger follicle. However, this is something for which clinicians can be trained and then can be relatively easily overcome. But most of all, the efficiency to IVF is still low. So when we compare IVM results in terms of blastocyst rate with the best option IVF for PCOS patients, we still see that with the standard IVM, we had 28% of blastocyst rate yield, just one third. The reason why then we think that this is happening is because IVM is just not physiological enough. I will go a little bit faster on this. Eventually, I can discuss it later. That's why what we propose is a capacitation system in which we are targeting very small follicles, as you can see here, from 2 to 6 millimeters. And we are keeping them under meiotic arrest for either 24 or 46 hours by supplementing the medium with the CNP. This is our experimental setup. So we were, we could, in Belgium, we can have access to donated oocytes from research from EVM patients, in this case, PCOS women. And so basically, we were receiving a random amount, usually randomly, usually one third of the amount of the oocytes for the patients were addressed to research. And this was allowing us to have sibling simultaneously to compare these two systems. Yeah. I just go through the maybe last slide results. And thanks. Okay, so here I'm going to show just a summary of what we could obtain with this system. And for the main parameters that are of interest, usually embryologically speaking, these data are normalized for 100 oocytes, and here you can see that we were considering indeed maturation rate, fertilization rate, good quality embryos at day 3, and especially the portion of the excellent quality embryo at day 3, and plus the blastocyst rate at day 5 or 6. And you can immediately see that there was 46% of increment in the maturation rate, which was translated in a double amount of either good quality embryo at day 3 and the blastocyst at day 6. And when we compare this data also with, as I was saying, the best option for PCOS women available at the moment with the IVF, you can see that there is still a little gap in the blastocyst yield, but for the other parameters, we are getting very close. And also, transzonal projections are very beautifully maintained after 24 hours of meiotic arrest and even after 46 hours of meiotic arrest.
So we do need to bring your presentation to an end. Very good.